All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Late Night Action with Alex Falcone. We have a tremendous show for you tonight. Your first guest this evening is going to be Daniel H. Wilson, the author of fabulous sci-fi novels. Give it up! We also have Willamette Week, most funniest human being in the city, Miss Amy Miller. We have special guest improv, hilarious quadruplette. There's 5 to 4 people in that group, Whiskey Tango. And of course, Politico, Mr. Steve Novick. And marching band, Love Bomb, a go-go. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together right now for your host, Mr. Alex Falco.
Being here, everybody. Oh, this is so cool. There are so many of you. I'm gonna read off cards instead of a phone because I'm a professional. We're gonna start by talking about the news. I've restarted with the snow. I'm also going to start with the snow because that's obviously where we have to talk about. City officials said this week they still do not know the cost of all of the snow removal that they had to do. And we know that it was expensive, right? Because it costs a lot to get snowplow drivers to drive around in circles and wait for the rain to do it. Not cheap. In their defense, they're from Portland, so they don't know how to drive in the snow. Washington company this week recalled 230,000 pounds of dried egg product that they sell in 1,000-pound sacks. They were worried about salmonella, but the rest of the products were also recalled because of fears of the phrase dried egg product sold in sacks. I'm really upset. Like, the last thing I need right now is a run on dried egg products. How am I gonna make Grandma Falcone's dried egg product pie? Now with 50% more dried egg product, it's not just a dried egg, it's a dried egg product. Also bad news, other business news this week. Millions of Hot Pockets were recalled because the meat came from diseased cows. Fans of the food said, wow, that is exactly the type of news we'd be worried about if we weren't the kind of people to buy Hot Pockets. So many recalls this week, you guys. Also, 3.7 million children's car seats were recalled because of major malfunctions. The recall wasn't the company's first choice. The original plan was to rename them the Mach 3 Kid Cannon. Somebody doing good, though. Facebook this week announced they're going to allow you to choose from over 50 genders when you sign up for the service, which is pretty exciting. Those include gender fluid, neither, and quote, I'm totally not a bot who's trying to hack your account. Who said that? In related news, MySpace is now offering to call you whatever you want. Please come back. Kells owners are complaining this week about the amount of human excrement they find on their sidewalk every day. It's not funny, you guys. It's a really sad thing to call hipsters in Old Town. The classic late night action, oh snap, from everybody. This week, my favorite story of the week, by far this week, favorite story, New Zealand Prime Minister was forced to respond to criticism that he was a lizard person. He denied it, but of course, that's just what a lizard person would do. Even more incriminating, after he denied it, he ate a cricket person. Said whoever New Zealand's equivalent of Donald Trump is, at least he's not Kenyan. Really good, bad for New Zealand, Donald Trump. Washington lawmakers this week are finalizing a bill that would prevent minors from using tanning salons.
Yeah.
Preferring instead that their children remain ugly. That was a little nutty. Also, it's going to do serious damage to the Washington's famous Hot Child in the City Children's Tanning Salon and Ball Pit. The Portland Timbers announced that they've sold the naming rights to the stadium again. Did you guys notice this? Yeah. It's now Providence Stadium instead of Jelbon Stadium. Timbers fans they reacted to this by getting super drunk and not paying attention. When we reached them for comment, Jelbon said, "Wait, who the f*** are we?" Power outage at the Oak Lodge sanitation plant spilled 440,000 gallons of sewage into the Willamette. The city applauded their effort at keeping the river smelling the same. Sorry, Steve. Portland teachers avoided a strike this week. "I am so happy to go back to school," said the most punched child. Other school news this week, a new Oregon law is going to require parents who want to exempt their children from vaccinations, it's going to require them to watch an hour-long video. The video is titled, "So Obviously You Think You're a Doctor." And it shows you how to fill out a med school application and apologize to your neighbors for whooping cough. Lastly this week, Dave's Killer Bread founder Dave Dahl posted $52,000 in bail this week.
Woo!
Good for him, yeah. Oddly though, the money he turned in had a load of seeds on it. Like, way more seeds than you'd expect. And that's the monologue, you guys!
How are you doing, Bree? Welcome back.
Good, great show tonight.
It's so good, you had to look it up on your phone.
Well, you know, I do drugs, and I'm not gonna lie, I don't care.
That was a solid apology.
Well, we're gonna be on public access. I just think, let's do it, you know? Let's come clean.
We are the only show on public access that is not about pot, so now you've finally taken care of that. Really is exciting. Did you see one of the things that I didn't mention the monologue? One of my favorite stories this week. Did you see Ernest Hemingway's favorite hamburger?
No.
Do you guys see this? Any of you? Yeah. So the John F. Kennedy Library just released the Hemingway Letters Project, and included in these letters from Hemingway was his recipe for his favorite hamburger.
Is it In-N-Out? Those are great. Right? In-N-Out?
Yeah.
It was not. That was not mentioned. No, it was a recipe to make it himself.
Oh.
It was not just like directions to a restaurant. That is the laziest recipe. Get in a car.
That's Siri's favorite hamburger.
It's really great. It's super specific. It's got very specific instructions. So what we did is I wanted to do a dramatic reading of it because it's really great. So I've invited on improv supergroup Whiskey Tango to read it. Please welcome Whiskey Tango, everybody!
This is Hemingway's favorite hamburger. Find the loneliest cow. Drink with it in the woods. Through four of the harshest winters in years. Name it after your father. Then take your grandfather's shotgun and destroy it. Like so many men at war, in service for God and country. Take it apart with a knife given to you by your first wife. Your only true love. Whisper her name as you build a fire out of cedar planks. Season with cilantro and truffle butter. Eat alone.
Hemingway's favorite hamburger, everybody. We were all so inspired by this, you guys, that what we decided to do was we had our crack research staff find other authors' favorite recipes. Whiskey Tango will read some more of them for us.
Carl Sagan's apple pie. To make an apple pie, you must first create the universe. I'll wait. Okay. Now that the hard part's done, collect the ingredients from a local store. As you prepare the pie, reflect upon how every atom in you and the apple and the crust all came from stardust, and now together they come again. Bake both the pie and yourself. Yourself in the oven of one's own creation and thought, and the pie in an oven made by GE or some other oven company. Feel small, but satisfied.
Nicholas boxes spaghetti. Gaze across your kitchen and lock eyes with the most beautiful spaghetti you have ever seen. Speckled with oregano and oozing marinara, the spaghetti instantly takes your breath away. It is also attracted to you. You kiss in the rain. Suddenly, discover that the spaghetti has stage 4 cancer. Grieve and pull away, telling the spaghetti that you no longer love it in order to save yourself the pain of losing it. Take a walk on the beach. Realize that the spaghetti needs you and devote yourself to it wholeheartedly. Your endless love will cure the spaghetti's terminal cancer in less than 2 months. Serves too.
Dostoevsky's Gulag Surprise. Ingredients, rocks. Directions, take rocks in hand. You tried to eat rocks. You cannot. You will never see your family again. Serves no one.
Gabe, that's kind of a dark place to end. Do you have maybe like the lighter menu?
Actually, we do, Alex. There's also Kurt Vonnegut's Slaughterhouse 5 meat pizza. We have the stuffed grape leaves of wrath. The diary of Anne Frank's and beans. It's an old family recipe. It's good. Sophie's choicest meats. And then finally, my personal favorite, the old man and the sea salt and vinegar chips.
That's a good one. Whiskey Tango, everybody! Whiskey Tango. That was the biggest laugh that the phrase stage 4 cancer has ever gotten. Kudos to you, bloodthirsty individuals.
You guys have lived privileged lives.
Are you guys ready for your first guest today? Your first guest? All right, your first guest is super awesome. He's a contributing editor at Popular Mechanics. He is a New York Times bestselling author. His newest book is Amped. Please welcome to the stage, Daniel H. Wilson! So much for being here, Daniel. This is Amped, you guys. This is his newest book. I have 4 pages left. I have read everything but the last 4 pages. No spoilers during this interview.
I'm itching to just tell you how it is.
Oh, I want to know. But they don't. You don't want to tell them either. That wouldn't be fair. So you have written a bunch of books, most of them involving robots and people having trouble.
Yeah, oh, you know.
Not getting along.
Some little bit of friction.
But you also have a PhD from Carnegie Mellon in robotics.
Yeah.
What did robots do to you?
You know, I just, I love robots, actually. You know, I spent a lot of time studying them, and then I just started writing about them, and I was really surprised that anybody actually cared at all.
About your writing or about robots?
About me writing about robots, right? I mean, I wasn't really thinking about that whenever I was in college and I was looking at the potential things to study and I was treating my life like a role-playing game and I thought, ooh, robotics would be an excellent skill for my character.
Okay, so, but does your science fact brain have trouble with science fiction?
Well, so the actual science part is quite slow and it requires a lot of thinking. And you know, you're literally in a basement, like staring at math equations all day. It's really great. I'd recommend it. But you know, now I take the same brain and I sort of apply it to a different problem, which is making up really grisly scenes of robots disemboweling people.
You do write that. So this is what are you actually worried about what's going to happen with robots?
I can't say that I am worried about it because I have all these colleagues, you know, from my previous life as a roboticist, and they're not happy about that. They're not trying to kill people. I really swear. They're really not.
So you're not actually worried about them. You cross your fingers. I'm not sure if I can tell.
Well, you know, I mean, I think that robots are scary in a lot of ways, and they have been for a really long time. You know, I mean, there's definitely a robot uprising meme that's existed forever, pretty much. And you know, it's interesting because it is timeless. I mean, you've got this idea of what does it mean to create something that does everything that we do, only better. It's inherently kind of threatening.
Well, so in Amped, what you're talking about is brain implants that make us better. So it's not just a robot. It's like, it's us.
Yeah.
Also,
you know,
a robot.
Yeah, and I do that in Robopocalypse, too. And Robopocalypse has a sequel that's coming out in June. That I really get into what does it mean whenever we start putting the technology in our bodies.
Robo-post-apocalypse?
It's called Robogenesis. Do you see what I did there?
I do.
You see how I did that? Yeah. That's from sitting all day inside while it rains.
Doing
that.
So in Amped, I got the impression that maybe you weren't afraid of the robots. It was the people you were afraid of.
Yeah.
Because it was the people without the robots in their brains that are the real a-s.
Well, exactly, yeah. And actually looking at the legislation that's potentially getting passed in places like Arizona, you realize how quickly, like, discrimination for, you know, various reasons, including perhaps having a brain implant that makes you really smart.
Yeah.
It can just happen like that, you know? And that's actually how that book kicks off, is with some legislation similar to that.
Don't tell me how it ends. I'm sure it ends with legislation saying, everybody's fine, be nice to people.
Yeah, no, they all get along in the end.
Yeah, good.
They're gonna work it out.
Well, so Robopocalypse also, I don't know if this is a sad thing to ask you, but how's your buddy Steven Spielberg doing?
Yeah, the heartbreaker, as I call him. Yeah, no, so Spielberg picked up the novel and they got 2 weeks away from production last year. And then he decided to pull it back and make it a bit of a smaller film. So I'm still waiting, but I have decided that I can't give any more of myself to Steven.
Hey, maybe J.J. Abrams will show up to pick up the pieces.
You don't want the rebound J.J. Abrams. Yeah.
He'll put a polar bear in it. It'll be awesome.
We open with a train wreck. I'll take it, J.J.
When is Robogenesis going to be out?
It's June.
June. So in the meantime, you guys still have time to catch up on Amped before you have to get to that. I can vouch for everything but the ending. I cannot.
It goes off the rails in the last four pages. I really phoned it in. I got so close. It was like those marathons where you just fall down and crawl, you know, over the last.
It's like senior year in high school. You're done. Yeah. Amped is on the shelves. Robogenesis will be in stores soon. Daniel H. Wilson, everybody! Please welcome guys, Linwick's funniest person, Amy Miller!
Everyone. Hello. Lovely to see you. I've officially been in Portland for 1 year. It's fine. It's all right. Not my favorite. It's fine. It's been an adjustment. You know, I'm from Oakland. I've been adjusting. One thing that I adjusted to right away. How many are transplants in this room, by the way, by round of applause? Yeah, see? See, speak out. We don't have to be afraid of them anymore. We're outnumbering them. But how long did it take you to do this? Because I was in Portland approximately a month, and I started to say this all the time. Started to say, no worries. Yeah, you say that all the time, don't you? I can tell. No worries. Why do you say that so much? We just heard a bunch of worries. Can't swim in the river. The teachers are going on strike. Half the people I know here don't have a job. The rest of the state is just smoke and meth, and everyone's like, no worries. A lot of worries. I'm worried about you. On a regular basis. I just don't understand that. Like, I'm not insane. I understand, you know, someone's 5 minutes late to something. Yeah, no worries, you know? Someone bumps into you on the bus. No worries, that's fine. I'm not crazy. But I was walking, admittedly like the worst human being, with a full cup of coffee, texting, looking down. I ran into a dude first thing in the morning and dumped the entire cup on his person. And I looked up at him, and this dude was just like, oh, it's no worries. I was like, no, you call me a bitch right now, mister. We're not doing this. Can't keep that inside. You're gonna get constipated. I don't know what happens. Just say your feelings, Portland. What? Did you guys ever, like when you were kids, did your parents ever say, don't swallow the watermelon seeds because you're going to grow a watermelon patch in your tum-tums? Did they say that to you? Yeah. Well, in Portland, people swallow all of their real feelings. And then they grow white dreads. It's dangerous. It's dangerous. One thing I definitely adjusted to immediately was all of the delicious and cheap food and beer options. And I have really packed them on in this year. It's awesome. It's just got out of, like, basically I moved to Portland once and now I'm twice, three times a lady than I was when I got here. So I'm trying, you know, I'm trying to get fit, like trying to slim down or whatever. But I hate the term lose weight so much. Like, it's such an arbitrary thing. Seems like something I worried about in my 20s, and now I just don't give a shit about the number, you know? It's just point, like, nobody's buying me at the honey-baked ham store and shipping me UPS to grandma. Like, it doesn't matter what the number is. There's a few scenarios in which someone might need to know your actual weight number. You're gonna wrestle. Professionally. You're gonna jump out of a plane strapped to that person. Or that person wants to know how long to keep you in the oven. And I'm not doing the first two sports. And if I get into the third scenario, I'm not telling him how much. If anything, I'm gonna tell him less, so then I get overcooked and when he eats me, I'm gonna be really dry. Don't make that dirty. Get your minds out of the gutter. It's gross. But I do this consultation with like a personal trainer dude, you know? And like, I don't care about weight, so it's hard to like explain my goals to him. So I sit down and I was like, here, I'll tell you, like I have some practical goals. Like one is, you know, like I was in my 20s, like, I could go to the club and put on really high heels and like drop it to the floor. You know what I mean? Like hit the dance floor with my bottom. I can't do that anymore. I don't have the quad strength. And and this trainer is like, how old are you? Like, oh, I'm 33. He's like, you need to drop it at the club still? Are you? Listen, Brian, you don't know my life. You don't know what's happening at the club. Maybe a blind lady dropped some money and I'm the only one that saw it. And I have these heels on, I gotta get down there somewhere. And he just writes down like strength and legs, which is not what I said at all. One of the reasons that I actually moved from home was that I got dumped for my first time ever, a bad breakup. Anybody been dumped in this room? Two sort ofs and 200 liars. I'm looking at you guys and some of you have been dumped, okay? For sure. For sure. Just let it out. I got dumped and that's a really hard thing to go through. On top of it, I got dumped by one of these people, holler if you've met him, who used to be very, very religious, but isn't Christian anymore, but still lives in a fun shame spiral of judgment and projection. Yeah, we know that guy. That's the guy who broke up with me. And like, here's something that he would do. He would only have sex with his socks on. What? I don't, no offense to any of the men in the room that do that, but what is that? Like, you can't feel the fires of hell that way on your feet when we fornicate? Is that what that's for? I know it's not helping for traction because I have hardwood floors. You guys ever seen a newborn puppy try to run on hardwood floors? That's how we were having sex, puppy style. It's not as adorable as it sounds. So that's the guy that broke my heart. Now you know him. He dumped me, and when he broke up with me in the conversation, he said something that I thought was extremely hurtful. He said, "Amy, it's just like, it's like all the other guys you've been with. It's like when we're together, they're all I can think about." I was like, "Oh my God, what a coincidence." Samesies. Hey, thanks, guys.
Amy Miller, everybody! How's Portland comedy treated you from the Bay Area? How's the transition been?
It's been great. I don't know. Everyone's pretty nice and very passive.
Well, so you...
I guess. She secretly hates me. You would never know it. It's great. No, don't worry about it.
You got this, the Willamette Week, took the poll, you were the funniest comic. How has your life changed since your face was on the picture of the Willamette Week?
It really hasn't changed that much. That was it. It hasn't at all. Like, once I got like a free buffalo chicken salad, and that was probably the only...
Did you see everybody's faces light up?
I love buffalo. You could put buffalo sauce on my dead grandmother and I'd probably eat it. It's so good. It's my favorite. That was a weird thing. Because I was so new here.
Yeah.
What you guys might not know is it was a jury of our peers. Mm-hmm. So like comics and like club people voted.
People? Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm not by any means the funniest. I'm just the most likable comic. Like, Bree was on that list, very likable. You know, your attitude, maybe next year.
thanks for coming on my show and making it weird for me.
Anytime.
So you've also got a podcast, which is a good comedian thing to do, but your podcast is super different than a lot of other comedians' podcasts in that it's not just three drunk guys talking about the week.
Yeah.
Tell us about your podcast.
My podcast is called Sorry About Your Dad. And I pretty much just interview people about their dad issues. Just get right to it. The thing is that, like, a lot of those podcasts that are just 3 to 17 comedians, like, getting drunk and talking about whatever, uh-huh. It always gets around to dad. Everything does. Who saw the Lego movie? Like, just out of nowhere, you're like, fun Lego movie, woo-woo, oh, shit. Dad issues. It's just everywhere. So why not just start with that and then work backwards?
Where can people find that?
Sorryaboutyourdad.com.
So also on iTunes?
Yes, on iTunes.
And and we can find more about you at amymillercomedy.com.
Yes. So many websites.
Yeah.
I'm on Twitter. I got Facebook.
You are great on Twitter. And I say that is not... Like, a lot of comedians who are great are not good on Twitter. You were great on Twitter.
Thank you so much, Alex.
So you guys should all follow at Amy Miller?
Yeah, just Amy Miller.
You were the first Amy Miller. Oh, that's
no, cool. It's kind of, actually, it took a really long time to get that name. It's kind of a long story.
Oh.
Not to name drop, but I knew people at Twitter, and they got... There's a porn star.
Can you talk to them for me? Because there is a bass player in Italy in a cover band.
Yes.
Named Alex Falcone, and he has 4 followers... 3 of them are in his band.
Yeah. You deserve that.
I deserve that name.
Yeah. You do. I'll see what I can do.
Great. This has been a very productive time for both of us. I'm glad we can have you here. Thank you so much. AmyMillerComedy.com. Amy Miller! So, Bree, we mentioned that Amy, I think we mentioned Amy is going to be in Bridgetown this year.
Yeah.
You are going to be in Bridgetown this year.
You are going to be in Bridgetown this year?
This show is going to be in Bridgetown this
what?
Year.
Late night action at Bridgetown.
How cool is that? So we're going to have an awesome late night action with big name comedians from around the country.
Maybe Reggie Watts?
Let's just say that now. They'll never remember. Reggie Watts is going to be on our show as the band leader.
What?
You heard it here first.
Is it okay for us to...
One of the producers of Bridgetown has just informed me.
And apparently she's not okay with lying.
Yeah. We're lying. That was the thing, as we were lying.
We don't know who it's going to be, but it's going to be someone awesome.
It's going to be
obviously.
Super awesome. So you can, if you sign the email list, you'll find out about that. And are you ready for our next guest? Yeah. You guys, he is a city commissioner for this city that you are in. Please welcome Steve Novick. Thank you for being here, Steve. There you go. Sorry about the monologue. I said some things.
Well, I think it wasn't our fault that the sewage got in the river. That was cities upstream from us.
Yes.
We're doing just fine. Blame Clackamas, as usual.
Yeah!
Actually, the thing you just said about Clackamas is awesome because it's not super politician-y.
Some of my best friends are Clackistanis. I should say that for the record.
Townies? So this is one of the things that's so cool about you is that you say funny things and you're not... How is it that you manage to be funny in public and like talk about things honestly and still run for office? That seems like they should be opposites.
Well, first of all, I'm not that funny. But actually, I mean, I think that some people in politics are convinced by the pollsters that they have to calculate every word and, like, remember each poll when they say each thing. Mm-hmm. And the truth is that that doesn't really matter very much because most people, they know they'll disagree with you on a few things, but as long as they think they agree with you on some things and think that you're being straight with them, then they're fine. So it's not really a political liability.
That sounds super reasonable. Why is no one else doing that?
Well, some people actually have. I remember in 1986, Alan Cranston. I was in California. Actually, I was living in Oakland. And Alan Cranston, this old warhorse of a liberal, was running for re-election as senator, and everybody thought this was the year he was supposed to lose to this blow-dried moderate from Silicon Valley named Ed Chow. And Alan Cranston ran these ads attacking, he would attack Ed Chow, that's pretty much all he did, but then at the end of the ad was, Alan Cranston, you may not always agree with him, but at least you know where he stands. And he won. And then 18 years later, I noticed that George W. Bush was running basically the same campaign, where his ads would say, you may not agree with him, but you know where he stands. You may think he's totally crazy and a war criminal, but by God, you know where he stands. And that worked for him.
Yeah, so I guess you're doing this. So you're just going with the classic George W. Bush model.
Exactly.
your blog post that you wrote, the letter to Santa. You wrote the blog post attacking the Oregonian in the style of the Seahawks
Richard
defender,
Sherman.
Richard
the Shermanator.
Which is what,
go Seahawks!
Yeah. And that got an amazing amount of play because it was funny and not holding back at all.
Well, actually, I told people at the Oregonian that it seemed to demonstrate the continued relevance of print media. Because normally we get 5,000 hits on my website in a month. We got 30,000 in a day when I attacked the Oregonian.
Yeah.
So I told my friends at the Oregonian, at least they care.
Yeah. So here's one of the things I'm wondering about. So you're on the city council, and a lot of the time I've noticed it's hard for people to get really worked up about city issues when they're like, or like read a lot about city issues when also like Justin Bieber got punched at a Starbucks that day. Like it's just hard to choose that news story. So what are your things? Give us like a couple, three things that are going on in city politics that we should care more about than we do right now.
Sexy city issues.
Okay, sexy? Well, not sexy, but we should care about.
I'll start with one. I have to do this. There's a measure on the ballot in May that would take the Water Bureau and the Sewer Bureau, the Bureau of Environmental Services, away from the city council and create a brand new government with brand new elected officials just for water and sewer. And in a way, that would be great because then people couldn't complain to me about water and sewer rates anymore.
Right.
But it worries. I head of the Bureau of Transportation, and we have a hard enough time coordinating who tears up the streets when within the same government. And if it was two different governments, that'd be a problem. Also, the people running this measure, it's a bunch of big corporate folks that use a lot of water. And my concern is if they elect their candidates, then they'll just say, okay, we'll raise the residential rates and lower the corporate rates. How's that going to work for you?
Right, and the advertising that they're doing, their talking points on this issue are the city could be corrupt, so give it to this corporate-backed new government.
Exactly.
Great, so water sewer, number two.
Number two is I would like more people to know what we spend money on. I mean, the city general fund, which comes from property taxes and from taxes on business franchise fees, goes almost entirely to police, fire, and parks, and a little bit to services for the homeless, and a tiny little bit for something that I care about deeply, which is preparing for the earthquake. And recently, I wrote a memo which to my colleagues saying, you know, I think that in order to pay for some of these other things, we might have to say goodbye to the mounted patrol. And people,
somebody hates horses in the back.
So, why do you hate horses, Steve?
And I love horses. And if we had all the money in the world, the Mounted Patrol would be fine. Yeah. We get all these emails from people saying, how dare you suggest getting rid of the Mounted Patrol? And I'm like, aren't you worried about the earthquake? I mean, aren't you worried about the homeless? Aren't you worried about the other things we pay for?
How much of the city budget goes to preparing for the robot uprising?
Well, that's another problem. I mean, we had a $50 million robot uprising reserve.
Sure.
But over the last 5 years, that's been reduced to $20 to $25 million.
Yeah,
and all the international experts say that your robot uprising reserve should be at least 30% of your general funds. We've got a long way to go.
Liberals.
So, okay, so we're voting against the sewer bill. We're killing the horses. And...
we're not killing them.
We're going to let them free.
We're turning them out to stuff.
On a field.
Let them run on the waterfront park and
hang out. So they can go find drugs or whatever their thing is.
All right, great. So horses, we're spending too much money on horses. One more. Give me one more.
Well, this is something maybe people know a little about. I happen to have the Bureau of Transportation, so mm-hmm. I spend my time worrying about the fact that we are not maintaining our roads properly. We've got dangerous intersections we don't have. Rapid flashing beacons that would save people. We've got places where kids are walking to school on a busy street without sidewalks.
Right.
So one of the things that I have to tell people whenever I can is we need more money to do that stuff. And every day we delay, it gets more expensive because roads are kind of like teeth. If you don't brush and floss on a regular basis, you're into root canals and extractions.
Right.
And so we haven't had enough money to do the brushing and flossing. So we're into root canals and extractions. It gets more expensive every day.
Like on Southeast Division?
Well, Division, I mean, yeah.
This might be something that he knows about, Bray. There's also streets that we don't pave, which is also weird. I don't know, from...
We've got something like 60 miles of unpaved streets. That's right. And, of course, if we pave those, then the maintenance costs go up. So we're really going to have to...
So much more brushing and flossing.
Yeah, it's like off-roading sometimes. Like when you're in the Woodstock area and you just take a turn, and then you're just like, oh, I live here now. I'm stuck forever.
Well, just live here now?
Actually, we did a poll recently on what people think is most important in transportation, and people thought safety and maintenance was most important. Something people thought was important but not as important was paving the gravel roads. And partly it's most people don't live in a gravel road. But also even some people who do think, well, if you pave the road, then people would drive fast down my street. And that'd be dangerous.
Yeah, but it's a city, right?
Theoretically.
I'm going to need to wrap this up. But this is not a quick question. But so you ran for Senate in 2008.
I did.
And then... against Merkley in the primary, and then
who has been a fabulous senator.
Yeah, so yeah, okay.
The man who broke the filibuster.
So, which you would have done too. Don't cut yourself short. But now you're working for the city. You could have been in Washington. Now that you're working for the city right now, do you wish you were in Washington, and do you want to go back to do you want to try Washington again soon?
It's just a totally different job. I mean, I see our congressional representatives, Herb Blumenauer, Merkley, et cetera, every once in a while, and I realize they're not like interacting with their constituents on the street every day. People don't come up to them and say thank you or complain, et cetera.
Merkley's never agreed to be on my show.
Oh, I bet he will be.
You think?
I'll ask him.
Oh, thank you. Yes! Clap for that. That's so cool.
But it's not the same sort of immediate connection to constituents. I mean, they're having to go to committee hearings, hearing from lobbyists, et cetera. Mm-hmm. They're not on the street hearing people talk about, you know, why haven't you paved my street?
And does that sound fun? Do you want to try that as well?
It's, you know, that this is a great job.
Yeah.
I fully expect to be an 85-year-old cantankerous city councilor saying, you know, back in the old days, we knew what we were doing.
Back then, we had horses and no paved streets.
And we liked it that way.
Yeah, we're fine. So keep an eye on Steve. You don't have to tell us whether or not you're going to be still in city council in a few years, but we'll keep an eye on you, and we'll vote against the sewer measure. Ladies and gentlemen,
Thank you, Steve Novak!
So what we're gonna do now, we're gonna do a sketch now. This is gonna be a preview sketch from the upcoming sketch comedy show, The Big Combo. Yes, good. It's from The Big Combo, which is written by our director, Caitlin Kunkel, as well as Livewire writer, Jason Rouse, an all-around good dude. And so please welcome, ladies and gentlemen, Jed Arkley and Leon Anderson in the scene, Wishbone.
I'm roasting in this case.
Good. It's the whole f***ing point. We're rotisserie chickens, Tim.
Hey,
Al.
Who do you think's gonna take us out of this godforsaken groceries?
It's the mouse wife, probably.
Aye, come on, it's 2014, mate. Gentlemen can go out and buy groceries and do all the family deeds. Come on, women aren't the only ones who can take care of things.
I know, I'm sorry, I'm just hot.
Yes. Salty, too.
Yeah, I know. That new deli boy's got a heavy hand with the kosher.
Yeah, he does. Hey, look. Look at that chap.
Who?
The suit, loose and tie.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I bet he's some kind of ad executive. Or mid-level internet salesperson.
Huh.
Yeah. You know what? He's respectable. Probably lives in a one-bedroom all by himself. He's got a den. Oh, he's gonna take me home.
Yeah.
I'll take that.
And what do you think he's gonna do with you?
Oh, cut me up. Cut me up, slather me with mayo, Elman's full fat.
Yeah.
He can afford it.
All right.
Put me on my white bread throne, make me a nice and proper sandwich. Glorious.
Yeah, come see on, me? Me? I'm looking at that one right there. Yeah. That lady in the red dress, she's been giving us the eyes of the olive station this whole time.
Tim. She's got shallots in the grocery cart, Tim. Shallots!
And?
You think she wants a pre-roasted chicken? She's gonna be dicing up those shallots with some garlic, simmering it in some olive oil, some complicated and exotic entree for her paramour. She calls her boyfriend her paramour. She's not gonna buy a pre-roasted chicken, Tim. You're beneath her, mate.
You don't have to be so crude, Al.
Hey, Al.
What?
You know what I want?
What?
I want to find someone who can, you know, just really crack a wishbone.
That'd be nice. It's a dying art.
Yeah. Can I be honest with you for a second?
Absolutely.
I want my carcass to be boiled down into a soup. So I can live forever in another incarnation.
Ten.
Oh, it'll be glorious. And not just any soup, Al. A cream of chicken soup.
I don't know, Tim. I don't know if you can hold up to the cream.
What's that supposed to mean?
I don't know if you've got the character. Chicken and noodles more your type. You're scrawny. You've got weak thighs, mate. Weak thighs.
Buck up, chap. Hey. Oh, here we go. All right. Yeah, top of the morning to you.
Hello.
Wow. Hey. How you doing?
Hello, mate. Hey, check out my thighs. Look how juicy they are. My thighs go on for days, as the kids say.
Hey, look at these breasts. Full of hormones they are. Yeah, I'm like a big meaty vitamin.
Oh, yeah. Maybe he's got the hormones, but look at my skin. It's crispy. It's almost sunburnt. You can take it off. You can put it on top of a salad. Check out those different combinations of flavors. You can take it off the skin, put it straight in your mouth. It would be just like melting like butter. Come on!
Yeah, but I'm bigger.
Yeah, but I'm juicier.
Oh, shut your trap. You shut your trap.
You shut off. Wishbone! Me wishbone!
I wish to be the chicken you choose. No, you don't.
Oh,
he's walking away.
Oh, no, he's not walking away. No, take me.
Come on, just take
me. Take me as half a chicken. I'm better than a whole cunt.
Oh, God.
Tim.
What is it, Al?
We're drying out.
Yeah. We are.
But. Another 10 minutes. We're gonna be inedible.
It'll be the trash heap, boss.
That's my destiny. And that's my destiny, and I'll go there.
Just keep roasting. Just keep roasting. Just keep roasting out.
Hey, Tim.
What is it?
We each got one more wish.
Yeah? That we do.
I wish for you to get your soup.
And I wish for you to get your sandwich, mate.
Whiskey Tango runs a monthly show called Ladies and Gentlemen. They are the gentlemen they invite ladies on. That's a curious comedy every month. The next one is Friday the 28th. You can learn more at whiskeytangoimprov.com. Also, that sketch, like I said, was from the show. It's from The Big Combo, which is going to be playing at Action Adventure Theater Friday and Saturday nights at 10 p.m. March 14th through the 29th. Stars Jed Arkley and our own Pat Moran, and was written by our director, Caitlin Cuckle, and of course, Livewire's Jason Rouse. Are you guys ready for our musical guest?
Are you?
You gotta be ready for this musical guest. You don't just let this musical guest happen. You need to be ready for it. If you got earplugs on the way in, this is gonna be a little, if you have sensitive ears, this might be a little loud, but it is going to be awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Love Bomb Go-Go! bum. Go, go, everybody. Who do I talk to? Who do I, Mars? Mars, thank you so much. This is, I just have this stupid grin on my face this whole time. It's so awesome. Holy crap, you guys. So here's what I want to know. Obviously, I want to know where this came from and surprise nobody by telling us that it had to do with Burning Man.
Alex, it's true. We prepared some music to be part of the Fire Conclave, the Inner Circle band. And we had this music after the Burning Man. We're like, what do we do with this? Portland. Marching band. Okay. We made a marching band.
That's so exactly what it needs to be, the story behind this. Are you putting me in the... What are you doing with your... I look at... Oh, that's all. It's just light. Okay, good.
Do the light.
I'll take that. So you guys are you're sexy space people who do marching band music, obviously. There is a story? Give us the story.
Well, as far as we can tell, we all signed up for some type of vacation, interplanetary vacation, and you inhabit bodies on Earth. Something went wrong. We're still here. We're making the best of it that we can. We sort of gathered a group together out of, orphans. We don't know what planets we're from. That's amnesia. We don't know. Sure. But there we are.
All right. So tell us where we go to find more about you when you're not, taking over bars or talk shows.
Okay. Thursday night at the Star Theater, we'll be warming up for Oakland's The Coup. Yeah. Friday night, we'll be warming up for the Red Elvises at Dante's. Yeah. Saturday night, Analog Cafe, Carnival. Zubumba's Carnival. You don't want to miss any of those. It's going to be a busy weekend for you. Thank you for coming.
And obviously the website, lovebombgogo.com. That is the Portlandiest events calendar I've ever heard. You guys are perfect. Play us one more song, you guys. Lovebombgogo.com. Lovebombgogo!
Thank you.